Amen. We have much ground to cover this morning, so we're going to move quick, fast, and in a hurry. Romans chapter 10, verses 5 through 13. Join me there. Romans chapter 10, beginning in verse 5. For Moses writes about the righteousness that is based on the law, that the person who does the commandments shall live by them. But the righteousness based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. God bless the reading of his perfect word. Paul has laid out beautifully, as we've seen over the last several weeks, this glorious plan of salvation in chapters 1 through 8. And this plan includes extensive discussions on Paul's part by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit regarding the nature of sin in the life of the unregenerate unbeliever. And he talks about how justification comes to the believer through that faith that the believer puts in Jesus Christ. Justification being merely right standing before God, that has nothing to do with ethnicity and everything to do with faith. That's been his point. Don't, Jewish people, don't put your trust and hope in your ethnic heritage. Likewise, Gentiles recognize that to be in right standing before God does not require a conversion to Judaism. It requires a conversion to Jesus Christ. And so he's unfolded what this faith looks like and what justification looks like. And that it's not by works. It is by Christ's finished work alone. This has been his constant and consistent theme. That we are pronounced legally righteous in Christ. Christ is our righteousness over and over and over again. Then he moves into chapter 8. He talks about the reality that we also, as an added bonus, if you will, to salvation, have the presence of the Holy Spirit. What an amazing gift this is. A wonderful benefit of that faith and of that redemption and of that regeneration. Then we moved into chapter 9. And we saw, as Paul turned his attention to the problem of Israel not being saved except for a small remnant, which opens Christianity up to the charge, potentially, that God did not faithfully keep his promise. If only a small number of Jewish people are being saved, and at the same time, large numbers of Gentiles are being saved, might that call God's faithfulness into question? Therein lies the full unfolding and exposition of chapter 9. So what's going on? And one part of that answer is that God has an electing purpose that cannot be thwarted. And he is doing all things to his own glory and for his own fame. Last time, we looked at chapter 9, verse 30, through the first four verses of chapter 10. And what we saw, I hope you saw as the main point, was that the righteousness of Christ, the goodness of Christ, the perfection of Christ that we have imputed to us, that belongs to us, is not attained by zealous hard work. It doesn't get to us by us trying hard. It is something that is granted to us freely through faith in Christ. It comes to us by God's grace, through our faith as the instrument by which we apprehend Christ. So the historical reality that we saw is that the grace of God is illustrated. The very living picture of all of this is illustrated in the salvation of the Gentiles in Paul's day as opposed to the Jews. You would expect those who had all the benefits of the Jewish nation would be the ones coming to Christ, and yet it is exactly the opposite. So the practical application or implication of all of that is for us, good intentions, even religious activity, religious fervor, does not achieve salvation. In fact, the harder we work to earn God's favor, the more it actually strips glory from God to whom it rightly belongs. God alone is the one who saves. And if we try to usurp His saving prerogative, then we are trying to direct the attention of glory to ourselves rather than on Christ alone, on the triune God alone, where it is deserved to be focused. So, we discussed the hard question, or the interesting question, of what is faith? Faith is one of those words that we throw around in church all the time. We even throw it around in our common conversation. Have faith. But what is faith? Well, many different definitions may be offered up for what faith is, but ultimately it's trust. It's reliance. It is dependence upon something outside of ourselves. And in our case, we know that faith is demonstrated in Christ. We trust in Christ. We lean on Christ. We sing, leaning on the everlasting arms. We want to lean, we want to trust, we want to hope in and depend on and rest securely in Christ and what He has accomplished. Again, bringing us full circle to that idea that when we stand before the Lord in judgment and we're asked the question, what gives you the right to be in my perfect presence, God says, we say, Christ alone is my righteousness. Christ alone. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. There's nothing else that I can add to that. So the bottom line, and what brings us to the verses we're looking at, we're focused on this morning, is all the zeal and all the religion that is absent true faith in the truth of Jesus is ultimately just an attempt to establish our own righteousness. And that's works salvation. It's denying grace. It's denying God the glory that is His alone. So in unfolding this further, this is, by the way, Paul's magnum opus, if you will. Now, everything he writes is by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, but this is a culmination theological work that is cream of the crop. And so he goes very much into depth, much more than he would in, say, a book like Galatians, where he's dealing with a specific issue, combating a specific issue, offering an apologetic against the Judaizers. Here he's unfolding the doctrine of salvation and its implications. And there is a lot to look at. And the very first thing that he moves to in explaining more about this idea of faith alone and God's plan in that faith is he makes this point. So if you like points, here's the first point. And it is that eternal life requires perfect righteousness. Cannot have eternal life apart from perfect righteousness. Why? Because God is perfect in His righteousness. He is holy. He is good. And you cannot be eternally in His presence stained by sin. You must be pure and clean, holy and acceptable before Him. Right? Makes sense. The problem is, that is just about the most frightening thing I could ever say to you. And I can say that to you because I can say that to me. If that's the requirement, I'm out. I do not meet the requirement. And I didn't meet... That's not just because of something I did yesterday. That's because of something I did in the womb. It's because of my nature. Not only something I did, but I did what I did because of who I am. Do you follow that? We're not condemned just because we do sins. We do sins because we are sinners. We are by nature sinners. And so you were born a sinner. And as soon as you were able, by your thought process and by the functioning of your mouth and your hands, you commenced to commit sins because you are a sinner. That's the constant message of the Bible, though, is that God requires a certain standard. Be holy as I am holy. And as frightening as it may seem, the standard is actually perfection. Jesus Himself says as much. Let me remind you, in that great sermon, probably the most well-known sermon in Scripture, the Sermon on the Mount, listen to what Jesus says following His giving of the Beatitudes and His encouragement for us to be salt and light. He says, this is verse 17 of Matthew 5. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota or not a dot will pass from the law until it is all accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Listen to verse 20. This is the kicker. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. By the way, in case you missed it, that's a high level of righteousness. At least the Pharisees and the scribes of Jesus' day thought they had attained a high level of righteousness, regardless of what the reality actually was. So the first thing that we need to get straight is that in these verses in Romans 10, verses 5 through 8 really, Paul is using Old Testament Scripture to make his point. He's using the Bible to be the source material for his teaching. Okay, so look first at verse 5. It's actually from Leviticus chapter 18 that he pulls this quote. Leviticus chapter 18. I'm just going to turn there very quickly. In verse 5. By the way, I'm going to take you to a couple places in Deuteronomy as well in just a moment. But just to highlight where this is, Leviticus chapter 18, listen to verse 5. You shall therefore keep my statutes and my rules. If a person does them, he shall live by them. I am the Lord. Now this is not the only place in the New Testament that Paul uses this verse to make his point. Back in Romans, same book we're in now, back in chapter 2, in verse 13, listen to what Paul said. I'm going to start in 12 just for context. For all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law. And all who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. Verse 13. For it is not the hearers of the law who are righteous before God, but the doers of the law who are justified. It's a difficult verse, a difficult concept. He makes the same point in Galatians chapter 3, verse 12. He references this. So what is the purpose of the law? The Old Testament law has three basic purposes. The first and most basic common sense level is it keeps order. Okay? It prevents anarchy and chaos in the community. Do not murder is not only something that is a reflection of God's character, but it is a basic rule to prevent chaos in a society, right? So that's the first thing that the law does, is keeps order. Second thing that the law does is it demonstrates the nature and the character of God, okay? As the most perfect standard of holiness that we could ever hope to live by. But most importantly, the law points us to Christ. It is a mirror. Paul says it is a tutor unto Christ. It is a mirror that we see who we truly are, and we understand that there is no way in our present sinful condition, this is before we're believers, that we can ever please God, and therefore it drives us to Christ as our righteousness. Okay? Now as he moves ahead in these verses, verses 6 through 8, here's what he says. So here's the first tenet. Eternal life requires perfect righteousness. Well, that's a problem because I don't have perfect righteousness, right? Well, here's where he moves to in 6 through 8. Gospel righteousness is based on faith. Righteousness comes by faith. So think about it in this way. You must have perfect works to enter heaven. You must have 100% perfection. You don't have that. But Christ does. And so, through faith, what is His is imputed to you, or accounted to you, or credited to you. So that when you stand before God, I say this again, I feel like a broken record, what permits you to come into a perfect environment? Christ alone is my righteousness. He has declared me legally righteous. Okay? So, in a sense, you do go to heaven by works. It's just Jesus' works, not your own. And if you stand before the judge based on your own works, it's not going to be long for the deliberations to come back guilty. So, now understand this. Full obedience to the law was the prerequisite for eternal life. But the law cannot be observed fully because we're sinners. So even in the Old Testament, the law was meant to point to Christ and to faith in Christ. Now, for the next couple of minutes, I want you to just hold with me because this is kind of deep here in these verses, but I'm going to try to keep the cookies on the lowest shelf imaginable. Okay, so just hold with me. I think it'll make sense. So verses 6 through 8 go on to reference even more Old Testament passages. How do we know that the Old Testament did not teach that a person could be good enough to earn salvation? Because some verses that you read in the Old Testament would imply that you could be good enough to earn salvation. We're going to look at a couple, right? And the idea being, God cannot ask us to do something that we're not capable of doing, right? And so if God says, be holy as I am holy, then you would conclude from that, it is possible to be holy, right? How can God ask us to do something we're not capable of doing? But Augustine, I think, has the best response to that question when he says, Lord, command what you will, but give what you command. Ask of me anything that you want, but you must be the remedy, the solution, the power, the enablement of how that is going to be accomplished. So let's look at this. Two more passages in the book of Deuteronomy. First one, where most of these verses that Paul quotes, all of this is a quote, right? So verse 5 is from Leviticus, and then in verse 6, but the righteous based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, and is to bring Christ down? Who will descend into the abyss? But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That's from Deuteronomy, okay? So go to Deuteronomy 30. Hold your place in Romans 10, and go to Deuteronomy 30. Now, the passage that I want you to look at in particular first, we're going to look at a couple of passages in and around Deuteronomy 30, if I can get there. Look at verse 11. Deuteronomy 30:11. For this commandment that I command you today is not too hard for you, neither is it far off. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will ascend to heaven for us and bring it to us, that we may hear it and do it. Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will go over the sea for us and bring it to us, that we may hear and do it. Verse 14. But the word is very near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart, so that you can do it. It seems the point of that passage is that all that Moses is reminding the people in this, by the way, this is a covenant renewal at Moab, where toward the end of Moses' career, before his death, he's recommissioning, recalling, restating all of these things that his whole life has been standing for. And here he basically says, all these things that I'm giving to you as commandments that the Lord gave to me are not too hard for you. It's not too hard for you. Well, that seems to contradict everything that we would think that I have been saying and that Scripture would teach. And so he says, in essence, it's not in heaven, so you can't reach it. It's not beyond the sea, so you can't get to it. It's near you. Some scholars, this is a very big problem, right? Paul seems to be using these verses quite the contrary. Because think about what he says, in case you've forgotten, back in Romans chapter 10. He uses these verses for almost the exact opposite, or what seems to be the exact opposite point. He says, but the righteousness based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, or who will bring Christ up from the dead or descend into the abyss. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth, in your heart. That is the word of faith we proclaim. You see what he just did? He applied that whole passage of Deuteronomy 30 to the gospel. He just said, Deuteronomy 30 has its fulfillment in the gospel. Now I want to unfold this for you for just a little bit, right? Because to say there's no work or obedience to the law that can earn favor, but then we have this Deuteronomy passage that seems to say the opposite. Well, which is it? Well, from Deuteronomy 27 verse 1 all the way through verse 29 verse 1, the blessings and the curses for both obedience and disobedience have been rehearsed. Okay? Moses has said, here's, if you obey, you'll be blessed. If you disobey, you'll be cursed. Okay? That's been all the way up through 29. Okay? And then as it unfolds in 29 and 30 of Deuteronomy, hold with me, this is so crucially important. It becomes very clear, very apparent, that Israel is going to be experience the curse. Okay? Moses says in his farewell address, if you obey, you will be blessed. If you disobey, you will be cursed. Let me go ahead and tell you what the curse looks like, because that's what you're going to choose. That's what Moses says. He says that in verses 29 and 30. It becomes apparent. Let me show you. Verse 30. Chapter 30, verse 1. And when all these things come upon you, the blessing and the curse which I have set before you, and you call them to mind among the nations where the Lord your God has driven you. You hear what he's saying? He's saying, when you remember that I said these things, you will be captive in a land and in a home that is not your own. So he already announces that they're going to fall victim to the curse. They're going to be disobedient. And he's already said that the Lord has withheld the grace from Israel that had been present in Moses' day during the Exodus. And he has caused them to not comprehend or perceive what God's done. Look back at 29, 3 and 4. Chapter 29 of Deuteronomy, verse 3. Listen to this. But to this day, the Lord has not given you a heart to understand, or eyes to see, or ears to hear. It says all this time, you still don't see it. You still don't understand it. You're going to disobey because it is your nature. Then a little bit later, he says that Israel's going to return to the to God following the exile after he has circumcised their hearts and removed the hardness that has prevented them from obeying. Look at verse 6 of chapter 30 again, Deuteronomy 30. And the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your offspring so that you will love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul that you may live. Now, where am I going with all this? What Paul sees in this passage is the fulfillment of that promise to circumcise hearts comes in Jesus. He's the fulfillment of the promise. God has circumcised the hearts of His people so that they now keep the law. If you doubt that, cross-reference Romans chapter 2, 26 through 29, Philippians chapter 3, verse 3, Colossians chapter 2, verses 11 and 12. So, the commandment in Moses' day was near to them in the sense that it was revealed clearly to Israel so that they had no excuse. But there are indications, Deuteronomy 3 and 4 again, that the law will not be kept by that generation, but would be fulfilled in a coming age. And Paul simply applies this to the coming of Jesus and a righteousness by faith, he says. Not a righteousness by doing things. And that's how the purpose of the law reaches its fulfillment. So you have to take the whole message of Scripture together. So how does Paul begin verse 6? Do not say in your heart. Well, it's interesting that Deuteronomy 30 never says, do not say in your heart. Did you catch that? But there is a place that does say that. A little earlier in Deuteronomy chapter 9, listen to what verse 4 says. Deuteronomy 9, 4, do not say in your heart, after the Lord your God has thrust them out before you, talking about the enemies, right? Do not say, and what is it they're not to say? It is because of my righteousness that the Lord has brought me in to possess this land. When you have victory, when you have blessing, do not say it is because of righteousness. My righteousness. That is precisely Paul's point in chapter 10, verses 5 and following. It's by God's grace. And even the Old Testament teaches that it is by faith that we receive righteousness. Good works are not the root of our salvation. They are the fruit. They come after conversion. They don't lead to conversion. You can't earn your salvation no matter how zealous or sincere you are. It's not based on works. And for his purposes in Romans 9:10, you're thinking, what is all of this about the raising up, raising Christ from the dead? You know, it says in verse 6, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down. Who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. He's playing on those words of Deuteronomy 30, remember? Talks about, shall we go into heaven to bring the word down? Shall we go across the sea to bring it back close to us? Paul's playing with that language. And what he's saying is, to try to earn your salvation is as impossible as dragging Christ from heaven down to earth or going into the grave and causing him to rise up. Why? Because who has done these things? Who has done these things? God has already accomplished these things. And so he's saying, you don't need to try to do something that God has already brilliantly accomplished. Just trust Him. Just trust Him. Can you imagine how difficult it would be If you have the responsibility of going up into heaven, retrieving Christ and bringing him to earth, and once he was dead, you had the responsibility of resurrecting him to life. That's your responsibility. You say, that is the silliest illustration. Well, that is just how impossible it would be for you to please God by any work on your part. Cannot happen. Impossible for it to happen. God alone accomplishes these things. So in verse 8, he sets the real context. Don't miss chapter 10, verse 8. The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is verbatim what Moses said to the people. But look at how Paul understands that. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Is that going to send chills down your spine? That when Moses says the word is near you, it's in your mouth and in your heart, he's talking about the gospel. Fuzzy as it is in his mind and in the people, it's still the same message. Put your hope in the Messiah that is to come. Trust in him. And we have the glorious blessing of living this side of the fulfillment in a new covenant, where how much easier is a trust in something we have seen historically demonstrated than the position they were in, to trust in a promise yet unfulfilled. The word is near you. It's in your mouth. It's in your hand. It's the gospel. That he paid the price so that you might live and you might rest your weary head upon him. Come to him. His burden is easy and his yoke is light. He will be rest for your weariness in trying to strive in vain after righteousness. And then lastly, the essence of the gospel is faith in Christ. This is what he says in 9 and 10. We've got to go fast because we've got to wrap up. But you know these verses, right? This is probably the most popular, famous, well-known verses in all the New Testament. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. Here in these two verses, right in the middle of the deepest theological jungle of Romans 9 through 11, we have the most direct, concise statement of the nature of the Christian faith maybe in the whole of the Bible. If you will believe and confess. You believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, right? He's playing on what was said earlier. You can't bring God up from the dead. You can't bring Jesus up from the dead, but God can, right? If you believe that, that's trusting God, you will be saved. In addition to confessing with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. This is the heart of the Roman road. You may even have memorized these verses. Many of you probably have. Confess and believe. Believe and confess. Think about it. The inward reality of faith that produces an outward demonstration of confession. This is objective, propositional, absolute truth. Jesus is Lord. And it comes forth from an inner, warm trust and dependence. That's the believe in your heart. You have to think about this in light of 1 Corinthians 12:3. No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Make no mistake, it's not just a matter of uttering the words Jesus is Lord, but you're saying that by the power, the animating power of the Holy Spirit. And then lastly, he closes in verses 11 and following. For the Scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Who is to hear this message? This message of faith. Every single person on the face of the earth. And this is the perfect balance. This is not in contradiction to what he said in chapter 9 about the nature of election and predestination. This is the perfect complement to it. For all who call upon the name of the Lord, everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. If you say Jesus is Lord and you mean that, that is the saving statement, if you will. That's the faith. And anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord in faith is saved. And some people so wrongly misunderstood and said something to the effect of, so you mean there are people that are elect who never trust Jesus as Savior? By no means. Absolutely not. Or the contrary. So you mean there's people who want to be saved, but they can't because they're not elect? Absolutely not. Both of those statements are equally insane and irrational. Why? Because everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Who are the ones who call on the name of the Lord? You have not loved me first. I have loved you first. We love him because he first loved us. But everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So guess what? You know what that makes my motivation as a human being, as a believer? I want everyone to hear this message of the gospel. Every single person, everywhere, in all places, at all times. And I want to plead with them. I want to plead with them. You are a sinner, dear friend. Christ died for sinners. Come to Jesus. And if you will believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. This is the only means of salvation. Christ alone. There's a general call, there's an effectual call, and everyone who calls on him will be saved. There's no prejudice, in other words, is what Paul's saying. Jews, Gentiles, those from every tribe, every tongue, every nation, all ethnicities, all social positions, we say to them, trust and repent. He will never neglect your call to him. Would you stand with me as we close our time? We prepare to observe this ordinance of the supper. So in essence, what we are singing now after we pray will be our heart preparation for taking this physical ordinance that is symbolic of the very truths we've been talking about. By taking this bread and this cup, we are saying that our only hope for salvation is the broken body and the shed blood of Christ. Nothing we bring to the table. The table's already been prepared for us. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the truth of your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.